Hi folks, it's Dr. P. Today I want to talk to you about dip switches. So we're going to be using dip switches an awful lot in digital systems. So I'd like to talk to you about what they are, what they do for us, why we use them, and some common mistakes that people have. So I have a dip switch here in my vice grip. I'm also holding one right here. And essentially all a dip switch is a package of several different toggle switches that can go from off to on. So the dip switches that we will use in digital systems each contain a package of 8 switches. Dip just means dual inline package. So dual means that we have 2 columns of pins that are parallel to each other. And when we put this into our breadboard, which I'll show you in a bit, we're going to make sure that the trench is in between the 2 columns of pins, and that will electrically isolate them. So I have a dip switch up here on my vice grip just so that I can show you how this thing works. So there's usually on a dip switch a little indicator, which you probably can't read the text because it's super, super small, and it says on and there's a little arrow. Okay, so what that means is when the switches are in the off position, that there is no connection between one of those sets of pins and the other. So I have my multimeter on continuity mode. So it's going to make a noise when there's continuity. And if I connect from one side of the pins to the other, you can hear that there's no connection. But when I turn the switch on, then there is an electrical connection. So this is just a toggle switch. This is just a convenient collection of 8 toggle switches that enable us to very easily and very conveniently switch from high voltage to low voltage connections, power to ground, 5 volts to 0 volts, 1 to 0, on to off, in a very convenient way. Rather than having to take our wires for all of our inputs and manually connect them from power to ground, we can just use this convenient package instead. Okay, so let's figure out how to connect it properly. How we need to basically put power, ground, and resistor connections in to make this thing work. All right, folks. So I have a dip switch in my breadboard. I have power and ground connections. And let me actually turn my power supply on so that works. And right now, I have power and ground connected to the power rails, but I do not have anything connected to the dip switch. So the idea about the dip switch is I should be able to stick a wire on the dip switch and turn the dip switch in from one direction to another in order to, let's say for now, just light this LED, but perhaps we want to use it as the input to one of our logic gates. So we might use several of the switches. For right now, I'm just going to use one of them. So the idea is if I take a wire and I put it in the same row as the top row of my dip switch here, I would like to be able to turn the dip switch on and off and see my LED light up and turn off depending on the location of the dip switch. Now, nothing's happening right now, and that's because this dip switch has no connection to power or ground. So what I can do is I can connect one side of the dip switch to high potential, 5 volts, okay? And now we'll notice that my LED turns on when I have this switch in the on position, and it looks like the LED turns off, but what we actually have on the other side of my dip switch here is what's called a floating input, which means there's no actual electrical connection right here. In the digital systems universe, that is a bad thing. A floating input is not good. It's an undefined state, and I cannot trust the output of a logic gate if it gets a floating input. So we always want to avoid that, which means I would need to make a connection to ground. Now, I want to caution you that if I were to just take a wire here and connect this directly to ground, I want you to think about what would happen if I flip this switch. We saw that if we flip the switch of a dip switch, that it creates an electrical connection from one end to the other. Now, if I have 5 volts on this side and 0 volts on this side, and I turn that switch on, what's going to happen is I'm going to have a short circuit. I'm going to have a direct connection from 5 volts to ground. I would end up melting a lot of things, which I really would prefer not to do. So clearly we can't just take a connection directly to ground. So what we do is we use a resistor instead. So what I do is I just use, this is a 1 kilo ohm resistor. In digital systems class, we'll probably use 220 ohm resistors. Either one is going to work just fine. And now, when this switch is off, no current is flowing through this. So this is actually connected to ground. And when I turn this on, then I do have current flowing through here. And this leg is connected to power. So what I'd like to do, I'd like to take this wire out and I'd like to show you how this looks with a logic probe, because a logic probe is something you're going to be using to diagnose issues with your circuits. The logic probe is super useful because it both has a high and a low LED, and it also makes different sounds depending on if it's connected to power or ground. So a high voltage sounds like this and you see the red light, and low voltage sounds like that and you see a green light. So when I have nothing connected here, I can always check that this side is connected to power, and we know that because we connected this wire here. And when the switch is off, we see that neither the high or the low lights flash, which I know you can't see on the screen right now, but you can't hear any sounds, which is important. When I turn this on, now I have a connection to power, and when it's off, it's a floating input. So floating is that neither high nor low, no sound is being made. So floating inputs are bad, and I guess I could put the probe here and you can see that neither of those lights are turning on. Now when I stick that pull down resistor, it's called a pull down resistor because it's pulling our signal down to ground. That is what gives us that connection to ground. Okay, when the switch is on, it's giving me a connection to high voltage. So the purpose of a pull down resistor, and again, it's called a pull down resistor because one end of the resistor is in our ground connection. The purpose of this is to allow us to have two good electrical connections to either high or low, depending on the direction the switch is, without having a short circuit. The absence of a pull-down resistor would either mean that we have a short circuit, which is bad, or we have a floating input. Neither one of those are useful. So this is how we connect a dip switch. Every time you want to use a new switch, you need to include another power connection and another pull-down resistor. So if I wanted to use all 8 switches of this dip switch, I would need 8 connections to power on this side, and I would need 8 pull-down resistors on this side. The common mistakes that I see about dip switches are that people forget their power connection. So what would happen if I left this out? If I toggle the switch, we see that the LED no longer turns on, and that's because it no longer has a connection to power. So we absolutely need to have our power connections. And another common mistake that I see is just that maybe it's one row up or one row down rather than being in the correct row. So the way I like to tell if there's a problem with my dip switch input is to just take my logic probe, stick it on the edge of my dip switch or my pull down resistor that's adjacent to the dip switch, and I should be able to hear and see the LEDs lighting up high and low depending on the location of the switch. If I see a high connection and no low connection, then that probably means that this pull down resistor is connected improperly. If I hear a low connection but no high connection, it means that my power connection is incorrect. So it's a really great diagnostic tool to use. Another issue that can happen with pull down resistors, let's say I have a whole bunch of switches that I want to use, and I'm starting to run into the issue of not having a ton of real estate on my board. Now let's say that these resistors start to touch each other. So I'm going to move this wire out of the way so hopefully you can see it a little better. What can happen is that these resistors can actually short together. Okay, so I'm kind of forcing them here, but essentially this resistor is connected to this resistor is connected to this resistor because the metal leads are actually touching each other. And that's bad, because if I flip this switch, perhaps switch number 3 is being turned on because of the fact that it's actually physically in contact with the other resistor. So anytime we use pull-down resistors, we want to make sure that we give them enough physical separation on the breadboard. We could even do this by putting our pull-down resistors somewhere else on the board where they're able to have more space, and then just giving some type of connection back to ground and back to our signal. Okay, so if space is really, you know, you've got more space somewhere else on the breadboard, it's perfectly fine to take your pull-down resistors and move them somewhere else. Okay, but we want to make sure that they don't get shorted out. Another issue that I see is the following. I will see people do this with their pull-down resistors. I will see people stick them all in one row. Okay, so both leads of this resistor are connected in the same row of the breadboard. Now, remember from my breadboard video that there's a wire, a terminal strip, hidden underneath the breadboard that's connecting this and this pin, which means that this resistor is being shorted. If I were an electron, I would absolutely choose to go through the wire underneath this board than through this resistor. This resistor right here in this configuration is essentially meaningless. It is not doing anything for me here. So make sure that both of the legs of the resistor are not in the same row. One leg has to go to ground. Okay, that's why it's called a pull down resistor, because it goes to ground. It is possible to have a pull up resistor. Let's see what would happen if we did that. I would have to move my signal wire to the other side. The pull up resistor goes between power and my signal. And you'll notice what that does is it switches on and off. So now on is to the left-hand side and off is to the right-hand side. So a pull down and a pull up resistor are just kind of the logical opposites of one another, and just changes the configuration of which side of my toggle switch is on and which side of the toggle switch is off. But for the purposes of this digital systems class, we're just going to use pull downs. Okay, so that's all it is. So again, the purpose of the dip switch is just to enable us to have 8 simple, easy to access connections from 1 to 0, so that if I want to check the truth table of a circuit and I have 4 different inputs or 3 inputs or even 8 inputs, I can just toggle all of these from 1 to 0 and check to make sure that my circuit is functioning the way that I want it to. That's it, folks. I hope this helps. Remember that there are plenty of resources that you can use to help work on your dip switch skills so that they're nice and charged up before you come to class. You're going to be working with dip switches in just about every single lab this semester, so this is a piece of equipment that you want to feel very, very comfortable with. All right, folks, until next time, stay well.